Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and the page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description, and the timestamping is also provided in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is with reference to the detention of minors who are under 18 years old in several cases of protests or democratic actions against the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. The news article mentions two instances where such arrests and detention have been made, one in Uttar Pradesh and the other near Delhi Gate in Daryaganj. Around five minors were detained by Uttar Pradesh police at the Bijnor police cantonment area. They were in the age group of 13 to 17, and around eight minors were detained after violence broke out near Delhi Gate in Daryaganj. And these minors were later released by a magistrate who noted that the detention of children in a police station is a flagrant violation of the law. In this context, we'll discuss the legal provisions with respect to detention of minors by the police. First, let us see some of the provisions mentioned under the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act of 2015. We know that this law deals with two groups of children. One, children in need of care and protection. Two, children in conflict with law. Those children who are found to be violating the law, they are called as children in conflict with law. And this JJ Act prescribes child-friendly approach in the adjudication and disposal of matters with respect to children in conflict with law in the best interest of the children. If you see Section 10 of this JJ Act of 2015, it deals with the procedure of apprehension of a child who is alleged to be in conflict with the law. For adult criminals, we use the word arrest. For children, we use the word apprehension. It mentions that as soon as a child alleged to be in conflict with law is apprehended by the police, the child shall be placed under the charge of the Special Juvenile Police Unit or the designated child welfare officer. Either the child welfare police officer or the officers in the Special Juvenile Police Unit, they shall produce the child before the Juvenile Justice Board within a period of 24 hours. This excludes the time that is necessary for the journey from the place where the child was picked up or apprehended. This section clearly mentions that in no case a child alleged to be in conflict with law be placed in a police lockup or lodged in a jail. So based on this provision under the JJ Act, detaining and alleged torturing of minors by the police is a violation of the law. Of some of the bodies that are responsible for the protection of rights and children in our country, one important statutory body that is responsible for the protection of child rights is the National Commission for the Protection of Child Rights. See, NCPCR is a statutory body which was set up in the year 2007 under the Commission for Protection of Child Rights Act of 2005. Now, this NCPCR comes under the administrative control of Ministry of Women and Child Development. The objective of this commission is to protect child rights, to promote child rights, and to defend child rights in our country. And here the child rights includes even the rights adopted in the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, 1989. This convention was ratified by our country in the year 1992. See, NCPCR emphasizes two principles. One, principle of universality of child rights, then principle of inviolability of child rights. Principle of universality refers to wherever the children are, if they belong to 0 to 18 years, their rights should be exercised by them. And inviolability refers to whatever be their conduct, their rights should not be violated. Now, we should also know that while at the level of center, we have National Commission for Protection of Child Rights, at the level of states, we also have state commissions for the protection of child rights. Now let us see some of the functions and powers of this commission. See, the commission can examine and review the legal safeguards for the protection of child rights, and it can recommend measures for their effective implementation, and it can inquire into the violation of child rights, and it can recommend initiation of proceedings in such cases of violation of child rights, and it can look into the matters relating to children in need of special care and protection. One among them are the children in conflict with law, and it can undertake and promote research in the field of child rights, and it can inspect any place of residence that is meant for children under the control of central government or state government or any other authority, including any institution run by a social organization. It can inquire into complaints, and more importantly, it can take suo moto notice of matters. That is, it can take the complaints on its own without the need for a person to file a complaint. And this power is with respect to complaints related to deprivation and violation of child rights, non-implementation of laws that provide for protection and development of children, and also when there is non-compliance of policy decisions or guidelines or instructions to ensure welfare of the children, and also to provide relief to the affected children. And while inquiring into any matter, the commission will have the powers of a civil court. And the commission has the power to forward any case to a magistrate having the jurisdiction to try the particular case. However, when it completes an inquiry, if the inquiry discloses that there is violation of child rights, then it may recommend to concerned government or concerned authority for the initiation of proceedings for prosecution or any other action as it considers fit. It can approach the Supreme Court or the High Court for various directions with respect to the matter of violation of child rights, and it can also recommend to the concerned government or authority for the grant of interim relief or compensation to the child victim or the members of the victim's family. So these are some of the important powers and functions. So since NCPCR can take suo moto notice of violation of child rights, it has the power to intervene when minors are involved in protests if they are illegally used, and also when minors are detained and tortured as reported. And the news article mentions that NCPCR has issued an advisory to the DGPs of all states with respect to use of children in unlawful activities such as stone pelting and other violent acts. Such use of children violates the rights of children under Juvenile Justice Act of 2015. How we can say that? See, according to Section 83(2) of the Act, any adult or an adult group, if they use children for illegal activities individually or as a gang, they are liable for rigorous imprisonment for a term which may extend to 7 years, and also liable for a fine of 5 lakh rupees. So as per the guidelines issued by NCPCR with respect to child rights in the areas of civil unrest, we should note that the police and military authorities should avoid blanket characterization of adolescents as security threats, and any arbitrary detention, mistreatment, torture of children has to be viewed extremely seriously by the authorities involved, and they also have to investigate any reports of grave violations of child rights immediately and should take action against the accused personnel or the offender who is involved in the violation of child rights. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. In the analysis, we saw about NCPCR and important powers and functions of NCPCR along with the news article. Now let's move on to the next news article. This news article mentions some of the targeted missions of Indian Space Research Organization. The news article talks about Gaganyaan, Chandrayaan 3, and also about Aditya Sun Mission or Aditya Solar Mission. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now, with respect to Gaganyaan, we know that it is the first human space mission to be launched by Indian Space Research Organization. So before executing the manned human spacecraft, ISRO has planned to carry out 2 unmanned missions, where the first unmanned test mission is to be carried out by the end of next year, that is 2020. And this unmanned test flight will carry a humanoid, which is nothing but a robo with human features. So within ISRO, who is responsible for the implementation of Gaganyaan project? It is the Human Space Flight Center, and this center was inaugurated in Jan 2019 in the ISRO headquarter campus in Bengaluru. So as we know, the implementation of Gaganyaan project requires processes such as end-to-end planning, because it's not a satellite that will be launched from Earth so as to stay in space. Rather, the human beings will be sent from Earth to space, that is to outer space, and they have to safely return back to Earth. there will be processes such as development of engineering systems so that with respect to crew survival in space, and there will be various matters with respect to crew selection, training, and also atmospheric re-entry and entering back to Earth. And this Human Space Flight Center will also play a very important role for continuous human space flight missions for our country. So we have planned to use the GSLV Mark III launch vehicle for taking humans to space, even for unmanned test mission. This will be the rocket that is to be used. Now the first unmanned mission will be followed by second unmanned mission, and this second mission is to be carried out in July 2021. Once both the unmanned missions are successful and gives hope that a human spaceflight mission will also be successful, then the human spaceflight mission will be launched in December 2021. So in this human spaceflight mission, India has planned to send 3 Indian astronauts to space for a period of 5 to 7 days. During the stay in space, they will be carrying out research at the microgravity conditions in space. The spacecraft is expected to be placed in a low Earth orbit of 300 to 400 kilometers. If the Gaganyaan program becomes successful, India will be one of the few countries to successfully carry out human spaceflight missions. Now coming to Chandrayaan 3 mission. Now this mission is to Moon. We know that while ISRO has successfully placed the Chandrayaan 2 orbiter into the Moon's orbit, we were not successful with respect to achieving the soft landing on the Moon. So the Chandrayaan 2 exercise is a complex mission that consisted of orbiter, lander and the rover. And the objective was to explore the unexplored area near the south pole of the Moon. Now the Chandrayaan 3 mission is also expected to be launched in next year. Will be a copy of Chandrayaan 2, but the difference is that it will not carry an orbiter. So it will have only a rover and a lander. So it's a rover and lander mission that is to be launched in 2020. Now these information were delivered by the ISRO chairman while inaugurating a felicitation program with respect to the celebration of 50th PSLV flight. The Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, which is also called as the workhorse of ISRO, has completed its 50th mission in 2019. The 50th mission of PSLV has successfully launched RISAT-2BR1, a radar imaging Earth observation satellite. And the launch vehicle used was PSLV C-48. And the target for the 100th mission of the PSLV is to be achieved by the year 2024. The year in which India has planned to achieve $5 trillion economy. Now, there is one another target with respect to 2020. Now, this is ISRO's first solar mission called as Aditya L1. It is scheduled to be launched by April 2020. Now, this mission will mainly study the solar corona. This will be launched using a PSLV, and it is expected that the Aditya satellite will be carrying 6 scientific instruments or scientific payloads. This Aditya L1 project will help us in understanding the dynamical processes of the Sun and also to find solutions with respect to some of the outstanding problems in solar physics. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next news article. This news article is about detention centers for the purpose of keeping those persons who are declared as illegal migrants or who are found to be illegal migrants. Now in this news article, we'll see about the powers of the central government and the state governments with respect to movement of foreigners in India. We know that when we talk about foreigners, there are 2 categories. One of them are legal migrants, then the other is illegal migrants. So here our focus as foreigners will be on illegal migrants. We'll also be seeing about what are the states where we can find detention centers for illegal migrants. And we'll also see some issues with respect to the recently concluded NRC exercise in the state of Assam. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. First, let us see the power of the central government related to the movement of foreigners. We know that foreign affairs is the domain of the central government. Even if you see the union list in Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution, Entry 10 mentions that foreign affairs is the subject of the parliament. That is, the legislative power with respect to foreign affairs is with the central government. And in line with this matter, we have the Foreigners Act of 1946 that has conferred powers upon central government with respect to foreigners. According to Section 3.1, central government has the power to make orders on the presence of foreigners, be it all foreigners or any particular foreigner or any prescribed class or description of foreigners. Section 3.2c of this act mentions that the central government has the power to deport foreign nationals who are staying illegally in the country. And Section 3.2e mentions that the central government can issue an order to direct the foreigner to reside in a particular place and impose any restriction on his movements. Here, the particular place, you have to relate it with the detention center throughout the analysis of this news article. And even with respect to the detention center, there will be definitely some restrictions on the movements of illegal migrants. Now, let's see the power of the state governments. In this context, it is important for us to see about Article 258 of Indian Constitution. Now, this particular article in Clause 1 mentions that the president may conditionally or unconditionally transfer some functions to the state governments. This is in relation to any matter of the executive power of the central government. Now, we saw that foreign affairs is dealt by the central government. However, as per this provision, the state governments have also been entrusted by the central government to take similar steps with respect to movements of the foreigners. So, based on this Article 258, the central government has issued many directions to the state governments in this matter. The news article mentions that in 1998, the Ministry of Home Affairs wrote a letter to all states and union territories which asked the state governments and the union territories to restrict the movement of convicted foreign nationals who had completed their jail sentence. The letter mentioned that those persons whose nationality is yet to be confirmed, they have to be detained in one of the detention centers or detention camps set by the states and union territories. And the states were asked to ensure the physical availability of such convicted foreign nationals at all times, so when their travel documents are ready, they may be either repatriated or deported to the country of origin or the country they belong to. Here, note that repatriation is the process of returning a person to the country of origin on the voluntary basis. But deportation is the act of compulsorily sending a person to his or her country of origin. Then in the year 2009, the central government issued another set of instructions to the states, wherein the center conveyed a detailed procedure to be adopted by the state governments for the deportation of illegal migrants, particularly from illegal migrants who are from Bangladesh. So based on this instruction, the state governments were asked by the Ministry of Home Affairs to set up sufficient number of detention centers. These detention centers are for the purpose of keeping the suspected illegal immigrants till the completion of their deportation process to their country of origin. Similar instructions by way of letters were sent again to states in 2012, 2014 and also in 2018. One of the recent letters circulated by the central government to the states on January 9, 2019 was about a detailed manual on model detention centers. Now, in this manual, the center has prescribed the various amenities that are to be provided in the detention centers, including medical facilities. Now, let's see the states where detention centers are established for the purpose of keeping the illegal migrants. In Delhi, there is one detention center in the outskirts of Lumpur. This center is under the operational control of Foreigners Regional Registration Office, and this is maintained by Delhi government. Know that the Foreigners Regional Registration Offices or regional offices function under Bureau of Immigration, coming under the Ministry of Home Affairs. Now, in Goa, in the place called Mapusa, there is a detention center which was set up in February 2019. And Rajasthan has a detention center, however, located inside the central jail in Alwar. New detention centers are yet to come up in states such as Karnataka and Punjab, and they are expected to come up by the year 2020. So, as of now, in Punjab, if you see, there is no separate detention center. Foreign detainees are kept in a segregated place in central jail in Amritsar, and a new detention center that is to come up in 2020 is expected to set up within a new jail that is to be constructed in Tarntaran district by May 2020. And it is expected that a new detention center will become operational in Karnataka in Bengaluru from January 1, 2020. Now, coming to the states such as Kerala and West Bengal, they had plans to build detention centers, but the projects are put temporarily on hold by the respective state governments. Coming to the status of detention centers in Assam, first we'll see the status of detention centers in Assam, then we'll see the issues related to foreign tribunals in Assam. We know that final updated NRC for the state of Assam was published on August 31, 2019. Now, this registers segregated Indian citizens who are living in Assam from the illegal migrants from Bangladesh and other countries. These are migrants who came to India on or after March 25 of 1971. Nearly 19 lakh applicants were excluded from the finally published updated NRC. And as per the citizenship rules 2003, the excluded persons from NRC may move to foreigners' tribunals that are constituted under the Foreigners' Tribunals Order of 1964. Those persons who were declared foreigners by the Foreigners' Tribunal, they were kept in one of the 6 detention camps in Assam that are set up for the purpose of keeping illegal migrants. And one new detention center is coming up at Golpara. So this is the status of detention centers in Assam at present. Now we'll see the issues relating to foreigners' tribunals in Assam. The news article has provided data on the cases disposed by foreigners' tribunals in Assam. You can see that there is a huge number of applications that are made to foreigners' tribunals. And in order to handle the huge number of applications, particularly after the updation of NRC in Assam, the Ministry of Home Affairs has sanctioned 1,000 additional tribunals. So at present, you can see that there are 100 foreigners' tribunals in the state of Assam. Now let's see the amendment made to the Foreigners' Tribunals Order of 1964. On May 30, Ministry of Home Affairs amended. This amendment was carried out in the month of May 2019. In this amendment, the central government empowered state government, Union Territory Administration, district collector and the district magistrates in all states and union territories to constitute foreigners' tribunals. So earlier, this power was only with the central government. However, with the amendment in this Foreigners' Tribunals Order 1964, now this task is entrusted also to state government, Union Territory Administration, even the district collector and district magistrates. And on June 11, the Ministry of Home Affairs has issued a clarification wherein it has said that the foreigners' tribunals having been established only in Assam at present, this amendment to Foreigners' Tribunals Order of 1964 is presently to be relevant only to the state of Assam. So these are some of the information with respect to the issues of foreigners' tribunals in Assam. In the analysis of this news article, we saw about the powers of central and the state governments with respect to the movement of foreigners or the illegal migrants in our country. We also saw the status of detention centers in some of the states and some issues with respect to illegal migrants in the state of Assam following the recent publication of updated NRC. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is about the formation day of Indian National Congress. This Indian National Congress was called as the first organized expression of Indian nationalism on an all-India scale. Now with respect to this news article, we'll be focusing on the formation of Indian National Congress. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Since 1850s, several political associations with reference to our freedom struggle were formed. However, they were largely regional in nature. Most of them are restricted to the provinces of Bombay, Madras and Calcutta. And since 1850s, the awareness among the Indians were growing that the British were controlling Indian resources. They were also controlling the lives and living standards of Indian people. And they also got an awareness that if the British control is not brought to an end, India could not be for Indians. Particularly during 1870s and 1880s, the dissatisfaction against the British rule intensified. There were several reasons. One is that they decided whether Indians should possess arms or not. This was done by passing Arms Act in 1878. And the British Indian government, they also enacted Vernacular Press Act in the same year, 1878. This was enacted, as we all know, to suppress those who criticized the British Indian government. And the act also allowed the British Indian government to confiscate or to seize the assets of newspapers, including the printing presses. The condition is that it will be done if the newspapers publish anything that was found objectionable to the British Indian government. And in the early 1880s, particularly in 1883, the British Indian government sought to introduce a bill after the name of legal advisor of the British Indian government. His name is Ilbert. The bill was called as Ilbert Bill. This bill actually provided some good provisions wherein it mentioned that Indian judges and Indian magistrates will be having the jurisdiction to try British offenders. The bill also tried to bring equality between British judges and Indian judges in the judicial system. However, since the provisions aimed to bring some kind of equality between Indian and British judges, there was severe opposition by the European persons who were then residing in India. So they have forced the government to withdraw the proposed Ilbert Bill. And Indians, seeing this, they were actually enraged because of the racial attitudes of the British in our country. And it is said that the way the proposed Ilbert Bill was amended and the way the Europeans reacted to the Ilbert Bill, which favored equality between Indians and Europeans in the judicial matters, has played a very important role in awakening nationalism among the educated Indians who felt the need for an all-India organization for the struggle of independence. And this is actually a prelude for the formation of Indian National Congress, which was established on 28th December 1885. 72 delegates from almost all over the country, they met at Bombay to establish Indian National Congress. The first president of Indian National Congress was Umesh Chandra Banerjee. And one retired British official has also played a part in bringing Indians from various regions together, and his name is A.O. Hume. And as we saw, the formation of Indian National Congress was seen as the first organized expression of Indian nationalism on an all-India scale. Now, you may take this table for reference, wherein we have highlighted the place in which the first three sessions of Indian National Congress were conducted and also their corresponding precedents. Since 1885, the struggle for independence revolves around Indian National Congress, and it is said that even the polity of early years of independent India is also influenced by the ideologies of this Indian National Congress. The party leaders such as Sardar Vallabhai Patel and Jawaharlal Nehru, they have worked with respect to consolidation of India as a single nation before and after the independence. So these are some of the information with reference to the formation of Indian National Congress. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. The first statement mentions that the president may, with the consent of government of a state, entrust either conditionally or unconditionally to that government or to its officers functions in relation to any matter to which the executive power of the union extends. Now, this statement is correct with respect to Article 258 of Indian Constitution. So we can eliminate option B and option D. Now, come to the second statement. Foreign affairs is an entry in the concurrent list of Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution. Now, this statement is wrong because foreign affairs is an entry in the union list of Schedule 7 of Indian Constitution. So, this means only the first statement is correct. Therefore, the correct answer is option A, one only. In this question, they have given two statements asking which of the above statements are correct. Indian National Congress was formed on 28th December 1885. Now, this statement is correct. The second statement, the first session of Indian National Congress was held in Kolkata in the year 1885, presided by Umesh Chandra Banerjee. Now, this statement is partly correct. The first session of Indian National Congress was held in the year 1885, presided by Umesh Chandra Banerjee, but it was held in Bombay. So the correct answer for this question is option A, one only, because first statement only is correct. Now, this question is with reference to ISRO's Gaganyaan mission. They are asking which of the following statements are correct. First statement, it is the first human space mission of ISRO. Now, this statement is correct, so you can eliminate option C. Now, second statement, it aims to send Indian astronauts to the low Earth orbit of 300 km to 400 km. Now, this statement is also correct. So, you can eliminate option A. Now, the third statement, ISRO's workhorse polar satellite launch vehicle is designated to launch the mission, that is the Gaganyaan mission. Now, the third statement is wrong because it is GSLV Mark 3 that is designated to launch the India's first human space flight program. So, the correct answer for this question is option B, 1 and 2 only.
With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar AIS Academy YouTube channel. for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We'll meet you tomorrow.